Hey, good afternoon or good late morning to everybody out there, depending on where you are in the country. Thanks for joining us today for our webinar. This is Frank McNally, and I'll be hosting today. And our topic today is on how to buy business intelligence and getting started in that procurement journey. It's part of a series of webinars on learning the market. And this one is in information technology. So what we really want to discuss today is, what is business intelligence, why organizations need it, and ultimately, how they can buy it. So this is typically the first in a three-part series, and so there will be additional content on this How to Buy Business Intelligence series of webinars, and you'll have more information about that as we go. All right, real quick about Public Spend Forum. Public Spend Forum is a market intelligence and best practices platform for public sector buyers and suppliers. We've been around for about 3 years, and we love what we do. And what we really try to do is provide government programs, buyers, and suppliers with supplier and market knowledge and data and best practice tools and information. And then the community, right? It's a global community of public procurement professionals from all levels of government, and suppliers as well, and really just connecting buyers and suppliers so we can more efficiently spend those taxpayer dollars. So for today's webinar, we've got three primary objectives. After attending, you should have an appreciation for how and why business intelligence solutions can help you or your customer. And that includes identifying the challenges that are best solved by business intelligence, because that's not always apparent. Secondly, we want you to be able to comprehend how the marketplace is segmented and how solutions generally differ within these segments that we're going to cover today. And finally, you will be able to conduct market research to identify the solutions that best help you meet your goals. That's always easier said than done, but we have some tools that can help with that, so we're excited about those. Our agenda today is courtesy of our recent report, The Public Business Intelligence Market Landscape, that was produced by some researchers over at Censeo Consulting Group with assistance from Public Spend Forum. The report sort of is organized around four basic questions. What is BI and why does it matter? What types of BI solutions exist? And how can they help you address the issues that may be facing you? What is the supplier landscape? And then which suppliers are best likely to meet your needs? We will be sending out the slides to everyone after our meeting has concluded. And there's a link to download that report. You can also find it on www.publicspendforum.net, right on the front page. So I encourage you to go and download that report. It's a nice read. Very readable, a lot of good charts and colors. So please do consider downloading that report. And we're fortunate to be joined today by two of the authors of that report from Censeo Consulting Group, Vinay Treacher and Richard Lee. Guys, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself, please?
Sure. Thank you, Frank. Hello, everyone. This is Vinay Treacher. I am a principal here with Censeo Consulting Group. I have worked in the consulting space for about 18 years with both private sector as well as public sector clients. Done quite a bit of work in enterprise-wide transformation, including getting both large companies as well as large federal agencies into the world and the age of big processes, better utilizing their data to make decisions and so forth. So it was an honor to be involved in the creation of this report and to share some of the findings with you all today.
Excellent. And, Richard.
Hi, everyone. This is Richard Lee. I'm an analyst at Censeo Consulting Group. My experience with BI ranges from being a practitioner of using it in my own analyses at Censeo, as well as from a more scholarly academic standpoint, researching all the solutions that are out there and how to best use them, pick them from an organization standpoint, as well as some exposure to helping federal agencies pick the right BI tool. And using those tools effectively in their organizations to achieve their mission.
Fantastic. And thank you all both for joining us. It's going to be a good session here. So let's start with, what is business intelligence and why it matters for your organization? Now, this is a graphic that I put together sort of to describe my understanding of business intelligence. And to me, it's about turning a corner in your organization from passive and reactive to proactive and linear. Like, it doesn't go from integrating your data to analyzing it to delivering information, but I do think the end objective is typically decisions and insights. I want to invite Vinay or Richard to sort of comment here and fill this in on the business intelligence journey here.
Frank, this is Vinay. I think the slide nicely captures kind of what is involved in business intelligence. It's most people, when they think about business intelligence, probably think about the kind of the very end product, if you will, the tools that you might use to visualize your data and, come up with charts and insights, that kind of thing. But really, the way we view business intelligence is as the whole thing, so it's really any technology that enables an organization and its end users to blend and analyze data to produce insights. So for example, the very first step in that journey might be, first of all, just getting your arms around the data that you have and integrating them. Data that you have, a data store that you can then actually conduct analysis on, right? And then finally, you get to the information delivery bucket, which is all about, reporting that out, visualizing the results of the analysis, so that the end users and decision makers can actually take data-driven decisions. So that's kind of what we think is involved in business intelligence. So it's not just about the analysis, but rather it's about pulling your data together, analyzing it, and then taking that analysis and packaging it in a way that is visually compelling and insightful and can help you make decisions.
Excellent. And we're going to talk a good bit about sort of foundational elements of business intelligence and where your organization needs to be, but I do kind of like that description you shared there, Vinay, about the ultimate outcome being decisions and insights, and then getting there is business intelligence can support you every way. I like analogies, so one way I sort of think about it to myself when trying to understand this is question, like if you don't know what you're looking for, will you ever really find it? I think we want to caution people that business intelligence solutions aren't a panacea and they're not like a magic wand. You sort of have to understand that it's about decision support. And the analogy that I share is sort of like, if we knew that there was this magical campground inside of Yosemite National Park and we wanted to find it, well, we can easily get a map. I mean, anybody can get a map, and that kind of represents like your agency's data all over the place. But the insights are, and knowing where to look for that magic campground, that's sort of the big map challenge that BI helps us solve, right? It can find patterns and trends that need more of our attention. It's kind of like knowledge of the area. So if we knew that the campground was near a waterfall, we could plot all the waterfalls in Yosemite National Park and then spend our time analyzing only those areas, right? So it's kind of a basic analogy, but it is sort of nice to see embellished by this quote from Joseph Sansoni, who's, I guess, in our report from the Securities and Exchange Commission. And Joseph has this great quote about what BI Solutions did for his organization. He says, it's the ability to see a pattern of multiple trades over a matter of months or years and gives us confidence to invest resources into investigations that matter. So basically, if you can consider the SEC having troves of data, their BI solution identified patterns of interest. And so rather than having to chase down false positives, they were able to spend more time looking at the signs that could actually, warrant more investigation. So there are a certain set of ways that BI can definitely support your organization, from increased enterprise agility to reducing costs and improving mission success. What are some examples, I guess, of how BI can support in these three areas? Richard, I think you have a few of these you want to share.
Yeah, definitely. So when I think about the public sector and BI and these three specific objectives that BI is used for, so increase enterprise agility. This one's really all about speed. It's not the fact that necessarily your organization isn't making the right decisions or isn't analyzing the data. It's more so that it's not doing it quickly enough. So this is incredibly imperative for situations where organizations need to pivot, where time is of the essence. One example that we've come across is the Incredible India campaign, actually. What they were doing at the Ministry of Tourism, the government of India had launched this campaign A lot of different reports were coming in across various silos, and the work was getting done, but it was manually inputted into spreadsheets, crunching numbers at the end user level. But in implementing a BI tool, they were able to speed up the reports that were coming out. For the second one, reduce operational costs, this is really about dollars and ROI. You know, it costs money to implement a BI solution, and it costs the organization's time to make sure that that BI tool integrates well. But if the successful implementation of that BI tool leads to better inventory, the ROI on that can certainly pay dividends. Examples here, classic financial management systems that are disparate, classic examples of those being unified, driving better decisions. The last one, improve mission success, especially for the public sector. I think this one is huge. It's really hard to quantify in terms of dollars, you know, how much value can an organization place on delivering clean water to the citizens, to going through tax returns more quickly, examples like that. And the examples we've seen here, and one of the things that we're actually going to highlight later is public transportation, utilizing data and business intelligence in a way to make sure that citizens can go from point A to point B more efficiently, more safely, and more effectively.
All right. That's awesome. Yeah, that improved mission success is a clear objective for public sector organizations, no doubt about it. Now, okay, so these are ways that BI can support your organization, but you also need to be thinking about sort of what are your business objectives, right? Because, yeah, we can definitely get these outcomes from BI, but you also have to think about really what you need as an organization and where you are if you're going to fully leverage and benefit from the business intelligence applications that you may incorporate. And this is where it does get a bit linear, in the sense that you kind of need to make sure your foundational data infrastructure has been reviewed and is up to par before you jump into business strategy type impact areas. And then even further, going from there to end user decision making, that's not something that you can enable in your organization unless your business strategy is designed in that way, and that's supported by foundational data infrastructure. Richard, I think you sort of put this graphic together. Did I describe it correctly? Do you have anything that you would add, and what more can you say about it?
Yeah, certainly, Frank. I think your description was definitely accurate. But one thing I would add is that when we were putting this framework together, the one thing we wanted to make sure didn't do was jump the gun on, you know, launching into this deep dive of researching the market, understanding what BI tools are out there, picking the right one for them. Putting a pause on that and making sure they take a step back and ask themselves exactly what are the problems that we're trying to solve for, and or do we have the structures and the systems and processes in place within our own organization that BI can actually, you know, cause a positive change. Ultimately, most cases for business intelligence implementation, it's always about making sure that the end user feels empowered to make the right decision. The end user could be one person sitting at their desk looking at their computer, but it can also be the CEO. It can be, you know, executive level teams within organizations. And if they ask themselves, you know, why are we looking at business intelligence? Well, is it because we need to make decisions more quickly, more effectively? And if the answer is yes, well, then maybe business intelligence is the solution for you. But going down to business strategy and the foundational data infrastructure, any fancy tool, any amount of gimmicks that a BI tool can give you, any positive outputs, if you don't have the foundation set, if your data is for lack of a better phrase, you know, garbage in, garbage out, if the data is not strong, then a BI tool can't make any sense of it. And for business strategy, the way we like to think about it is, you know, you're collecting data for data's sake, but if that data is not targeted in a way, packaged in a way to answer the most important questions for your organization, then BI can't make an impact there either. So that's the way that we think about it, these three impact areas. Certainly BI can make a strong impact in each one separately, but when you think about it holistically and making sure that it's the end user that's really getting the most of the impact, that's where we see business intelligence really having the most strength in terms of making your organization better.
Awesome. And we actually do have an accompanying downloadable that that folks can use that sort of summarizes these symptoms in a checklist format. So you can go through this with your customer or your stakeholder and ask yourself these questions, make sure the solution you're going to obtain for your organization is supported by, you know, these tiers and fits correctly, right? So don't buy an end user application if your data infrastructure isn't up to snuff. That's kind of what the tool is designed to help you do. So Vinay, you've been in consulting for a while and have done a lot of work with clients to help them understand the BI journey and plan for it. There are certain questions that you recommend that they ask themselves before they get started, and I was hoping you could share some anecdotes from your experience on this.
Sure, absolutely, Frank. And I think the questions that you have on the page here are definitely the ones to start with, right? And then you know, you can peel back the onion and go deeper, right? But I think some basic questions here, I would say, is if you look at this list of questions on page 12, to really kind of start at the bottom, if you will, right? I mean, you guys, first of all, do you or your customer have a clear sense of what you're looking to do, right? I mean, do you know the problem you're looking to have answered, right? And once you have that really clearly defined, you can then, I think, get to some of these other questions which can help you, you know, figure out what sort of BI solution, if any, you need, or whether you need something you know, maybe the tool is something that's going to come later, right? So for instance, that very first question, do you have good data management, right? Like Richard was saying, there's really no point buying a fancy BI solution unless your own processes for, you know, gathering and assuring the quality and governing all of the data that your organization has are not good enough, right? But I do think the most important question here is certainly this question around, you know, what is it that you're looking to do with the solution? Mm-hmm. Then you can get to some of the things like, hey, do we have the data that we need to answer this question or solve this particular problem? Do we have, you know, do we have the organizational capabilities needed to really execute and take advantage of a BI solution and so on? You know, I do want to call out that second question, the executive or a product owner who actually kind of knows what they're doing and is able to make a decision around, you know, what sort of BI solution is needed. Because in our experience, the BI marketplace, much like any tech marketplace, right, is very much driven by vendor hype, right? So you know, we'll get to this later on in today's session, but there's literally hundreds and hundreds of solution providers who will try to sell you some sort of BI tool or the other, and everybody will make it sound as if their thing is the best thing since sliced bread, right? And, you know, I think, you know, having a clear product owner who is able to work with the different stakeholders within an organization to develop that clarity around what exactly is it that we want to do, what exactly are our requirements, I think that's really important, because then that person can be empowered to go and sift through, you know, the vendor hype and try to come up with an acquisition strategy for the solution that best fits the needs of your organization.
That's exactly right. I mean, I think that the product owner or executive would have, and I mean, I've worked in public procurement as a contracting officer, and anytime there's a big initiative, for instance, maybe buying a big business intelligence tool, you get a lot of people coming in and they want part of that. They want, hey, can we get these solutions over here? And it's a real issue and a real challenge to keep that solution from going into boil the ocean territory. And, you know, at that point you're probably going to be buying such a big, you know, solution that you won't end up being able to do the things that you needed to do when you first identified the need. And I'm curious, because I know we're going to talk more about the diversity in this market, but Vinay, have you worked with clients that have had challenges matching or even, like, I guess, identifying that first business need and then being able to match it to the marketplace? I mean, is that a real challenge?
It definitely is. And, you know, I can think of an example, you know, recent project that we did with, you know, here at Censeo Consulting with one of our a regulatory agency, right? So it's an agency that has oversight of a particular industry, and then there's really the mission of the agency is to protect the consumer and make sure that, you know, the companies and the firms in this industry are not, ripping off consumers, if you will, right? And so that was the mission of the agency. And really, the problem that they were trying to solve, if you will, was proactively trying to find patterns of wrongdoing by actors within the industry so that they could take enforcement actions. Or, you know, oftentimes, frankly, folks in the industry may not have even been aware of all of the regulations that they needed to conform to. So, you know, at least proactively reaching out to actors in the industry to alert them to potential problems that their companies might be creating for their consumers, right? So that was the problem that they were looking to solve. You know, how can we proactively get ahead of, bad actors in the industry, if you will, and take quicker and more targeted enforcement actions? Right. So until then, the agency was unfortunately, spending a lot of money getting Frank, and then it took them quite a bit of time, and then they were very reactive. So they'd wait until something hit the press, for instance, or if they got a lot of complaints from consumers before they took any action. So once they defined the problem in that way, the next question they asked themselves was, look, do we have the data? So even before they went to the tools question, right? The question they asked themselves is, do we as an agency have the data that we need to actually solve this problem? And it turns out that they actually did. The agency had a help desk where consumers could call in and report issues that they were facing in terms of bad behaviors by companies in the marketplace. And they were logging all of this information. Now, unfortunately, they were logging it in a way that was not particularly accessible or user-friendly, right? So they had vast stores of consumer complaint data, which was all unstructured, free text stuff, not really categorized, right? And so then that gave them a sense for what kind of solution they needed, right? So they needed a solution to analyze and draw insights out of these complaints. So literally millions and millions of complaints, each of which had like maybe a page of documentation kind of, telling them exactly what the complaint was about, which company was being complained against, where that complaint was coming from, right? So they ended up going with a BI solution that enabled them to pull insights out of this unstructured text data and then combined it with a mapping and visualization functionality that would then let them proactively zoom in. So imagine a map of the U.S., right, much like the Yosemite map that you have here, right, which is kind of like a heat map almost, right? So color-coded with the kinds of complaints that were coming from different areas. And so this way, they could at a glance just see, hey, where are people complaining about, getting ripped off on their bills? Or where are people complaining about not getting good enough service from their, industry providers, right? And they could zoom in. They could see exactly which firms were involved. They could take those targeted enforcement actions. And because this was a heat map that was constantly getting refreshed, that was becoming red all of a sudden, they knew that something was going wrong there, and they could proactively go in and investigate. So overall, if you think of the outcomes here, right, I mean, they were able to deliver, execute better on their mission, which was essentially protecting the American consumer, right? So they were able to do that better. They were able to reduce their operational costs because they were now taking more proactive and targeted enforcement actions. And overall, they had become much more agile because they could get ahead of these problems even before, they became a big deal, right? So they got both the speed, the cost reduction, and the better citizen outcome.
That's fantastic. I mean, that's, a function of good planning, right? So it is worth, I think, doing the homework early before you go out, because it is a big map, but there are a lot of ways you can go. And if you plan correctly, the rewards are great. So we don't want to intimidate folks, right? Buying BI is it's not the hardest thing in the world, but it does take planning and effort. And then when you do succeed, the rewards are great. We're talking about over there. And a lot of organizations in the public sector have found success. And I think we want to talk about a few of them. I know our report goes really in-depth in each of these five organizations here that you see on the screen, in a case study format. So that's another reason to download that report. But Richard, you wanted to go, I think, deeply into the St. Louis situation, right?
Yeah, correct. So, in developing the report, we took a scan at the, what are the cases out there of organizations using BI well, and then if, time permitting, from when they started to where they are now? You know, what are the realized results that they've achieved? And a lot of great stuff has come up through our research, but we wanted to highlight that second one, the Metro Transit St. Louis Smart Bus Program, mainly for two reasons. One, I think we talked about, you know, the three business objectives that BI can the outcomes it can lead to: increase enterprise agility, reduce operational costs, and improve mission success. And this is an example where, you know, BI comes up in all three of those categories. And then second, I think it's from my own personal view, is that it's actually very interesting in that it links together business intelligence as well as Internet of Things. So I'll give a brief overview of exactly what went on here. So the situation is that the Metro System of St. Louis found itself in a situation where there were multiple reporting lines within its bus operation centers. So you had from there various disparate systems, people operating in silos. There was changes in emission standards, so there was a compliance perspective as well. And then also they had to adjust to a smaller workforce. So those three things of poor data sort of conversations, changing emission standards, as well as adjusting to a smaller workforce, that combined to a situation where they needed to do something. So what they did was they actually acquired new smart buses that were equipped with live time sensors. So essentially these buses were able to beam back in live time data regarding the bus, its route, its fuel levels, which parts may be. That was going to a BI tool that was centrally scrubbing all of that data in live time to find trends and then spit out answers to operators saying that these are the buses that may need maintenance sooner. These are the ways you can optimize the bus routes. This is how you can, you know, increase satisfaction to the customer. So ultimately what came of this project was, in my mind, I think it's phenomenal. It was 30% increase in bus lifespan, 50% decrease in fuel and operation maintenance costs. I think the figure was they went from 92 cents per mile to 43 cents per mile. So really it's, you know, lower costs, better customer service, safer operations, and they were able to comply with new regulations. I think it's a great example for, you know, constructing a solid business case. Frank, as you mentioned, you know, doing the homework up front. One of the key takeaways we found from this was that there was some hesitation initially to, one, adopt these new smart buses, given their costs, as well as retrofitting existing buses with. But they did their homework, and, you know, they said it cost this much up front. It may hurt now, but clearly it's paid off, and it's continuing to pay off.
That is awesome. I know what I like about this case study the most is that it's a classic example of dealing with legacy systems. In this case, you know, older buses. They didn't just go and get a new bus fleet. They retrofitted them with technology, and I think that's something that public sector organizations are going to have to do, because you're not always going to have the full funding to revamp your infrastructure or buy new capital equipment. But BI tools and Internet of Things, et cetera, that's what you can use to bring some of those that legacy tech and legacy infrastructure into the future. So really love that case study, and definitely the write-up in the report is really good. I think it's time to move on. Yeah, please go ahead.
Sorry, Frank, didn't mean to cut you off there, but I do think one interesting point to make here, especially given the earlier example I shared about the regulatory agency, right? Clearly, you know, the executives at these organizations started with the question that they wanted to answer, right, or the problem that they wanted to solve. Right, and then, you know, whereas the regulatory agency actually turned out that they had the data that they needed to use to solve the problem, but they were not really analyzing that data, etc., and so therefore had to go and get themselves the tools to do so. In the Metro's case, you know, it's interesting. They knew the problem they needed to solve. Then they realized that they did not actually have the data that they needed to solve the problem, right? Meaning that they did not have this IoT-enabled bus infrastructure, right? So they realized that they needed to first invest in getting the data, and then, of course, you go ahead and analyze the data and get to the outcomes that you see on the slide, right? But I think both of these cases, you know, reinforce the point around starting with a clear definition of the problem statement, and then figuring out, do I or do I not have the data to actually answer that problem? If you have the data, then, you know, you go to the next step, which is figuring out what tools to use, what techniques to use, and so forth. But if you don't have the data, then first investing in making sure you have it.
Absolutely. And then when you are thinking about the BI solutions, you have a lot of choices. I mean, this is where we get into the meat of our report and the supplier landscape. So you guys found five basic market segments, right? Richard, can you just sort of walk us through each segment? And I think, Vinay, you had a couple of distinctions that you wanted to make. But Richard, let's talk to me about these segments first.
Yeah, sure. So when we were looking at, you know, just all the suppliers out there, we were wondering, you know, what's a meaningful way to segment all of these suppliers and their offerings, but not get too crazy with it. And what we found is how industry tends to look at itself is bucketing it in one of these five segments. So for one, traditional BI platforms, these were the platforms that, you know, when BI was just getting off the ground, these were the large companies that implemented these large, you know, projects to develop these intelligence solutions. What we find with these platforms is, though it says traditional, I don't want to give off the impression that it's really old and or useful, but really what it is that it's focused at the enterprise level. What this means is you need a central department, generally speaking it's IT, but that department handles data in the raw form, packages it in meaningful ways, make sure that, you know, that there's a strong governance, strong security over that data, and then pushes that information out through a BI tool to the end users in the organization. The second one, modern BI platforms, this is where we're seeing, you know, more and more platforms that are coming out are giving empowerment straight to the end user. The phrase you'll always see is self-service. This is software that enables anybody at their own workstations to take data, analyze it meaningfully, visualize it, and then find insights that way. The third, organizational performance management suites. These are business intelligence applications that are very specific in what they're trying to accomplish. And what that is providing an organization with a corporate enterprise-wide view of everything related to what management would care about tracking for success. So things like financial KPIs, you know, how well are we satisfying our customers' needs? Those sorts of metrics are the ones being tracked at a very holistic level for these suites. The fourth one, packaged analytic applications. So these are BI tools that are focused specifically in one of two ways. One is looking at a specific industry. If it's a BI tool that is only catering towards the transportation logistics industry, that would be in this segment. Or if it's a tool that's focused solely on helping budget folks and organizations prepare their budgets and their numbers better, that would fall under this category as well. The last one, advanced analytics platforms. So this is where any solution that we found that was focused on allowing advanced data scientists to prepare and execute their models, those were advanced analytics platforms. Anything that we saw related to machine learning, to artificial intelligence implementations, all of those things we put into advanced analytics platforms. And it's a relatively new space, so in terms of all the segments at 3%.
Interesting. Then we're going to go through these segments in a little bit more detail in a few slides. But Vinay, why is modern BI such a significant majority when you're thinking about five segments here? That's 51%. What's up with that?
right. So Frank, I think one thing to keep in mind here is that you know, most vendors in the BI market tend to make produce solutions that oftentimes cut across some of these segments. So for example, you could have a company like Oracle or SAP, right, making both traditional BI tools as well as modern BI tools and so on. So that's one little distinction to keep in mind, right? So meaning the modern BI share of the pie is larger here because there are companies that might actually be living or might have started in one of the other segments but have now added modern BI solutions to their list of offerings, right? So there is that thing on. The general move, you know, industry-wide to try and get more and more data-driven enterprise-wide. So rather than having just one dedicated group of people who analyze numbers, but rather to get into a more data-driven mindset throughout the organization, regardless of where you sit or what your level of seniority might be. So which is why, you know, this move towards self-service, right? So where any employee, regardless of where they sit in the organization, can better use data to do their own job better, right? I think philosophically, especially in the private sector, we see that happening more and more, again, leading to an increase in the sort of modern BI solutions that are out there. That being said, I think one thing, especially to kind of keep in mind here, is these are broad distinctions between these big market segments, and as especially if you are a program officer or an acquisition official in an agency, thinking about, hey, which of these segments is most likely to meet my needs, I think there's a transition that happen first, some questions that folks will need to answer for themselves before figuring out which of these segments might best suit their needs, right? So to give you an example, for instance, traditional BI might actually be the right answer for you if, you operate in an environment where there's a high need for, robust data governance, right? Because you clearly want to make sure that there is security considerations that are taken into account and so forth, right? Or maybe there's a standard set of reports that you're going to share with all users at all times, right? In which case a traditional platform might be good. So hopefully that answers your question, right, Frank? I mean, the BI world, the segments are modern BI is growing in importance, but doesn't mean that the other segments are, not relevant.
And you said something the other day in our practice session, too, that I wanted to reiterate. It's just, you can be a modern BI supplier, but also, have a packaged analytics solution. So there is some crossover, and I think that's what this chart is hopefully going to help us understand, because there's a category, right, how you deploy or how you use or whatever, but then the capability, so a vendor in modern BI, as a modern BI segment, their capability is likely going to be software as a service, right, because that's a sort of self-service way, and then the traditional BI would be more in that perpetual license. That's not like a hard and fast rule, but what more do we need to understand about this chart here?
Yes, Frank, so this is Richard. So after we took the segmentation of the vendor landscape, we wanted to then take one step further and see how can we find more meaning and how can we cut this cake a little more minutely. So what we did was we found a variety of capabilities that BI platforms tend to show. The caveat here is that there's certainly a wide range of capabilities outside of the ones we've listed here that BI platforms are certainly doing. But we found those to be more nuanced, more niche, and we wanted to focus the majority of our research on these specific capabilities that we kept seeing time and time again. So what we've done is we've and I spent time and just run a quick overview over each. For deployment, what we're looking at here is how does this platform end up in the hands of the end users? From the IT perspective, is it deployed over the cloud? Do we need to maintain any on-premise infrastructure to support this? So that's your SaaS model there. The perpetual there is then, the classic, installing that software on your own machines, on your own servers, and having your own IT folks manage that software. The second category is usage model. And here what we're essentially distinguishing between is, does the BI tool primarily focus its purpose on being an enterprise-wide data source? So data warehousing is what we're calling it. And this is where you have an IT department that's centrally managing that data, analyzing that data, and then pushing that data out to the end users. And or is the tool really more focused on data discovery? And this is, on the other end of the spectrum, allowing end users to have that ad hoc analysis capability, giving them the tools to take their own data and any other data and running their own analyses on it to find their own insights. The third category of analytics, we wanted to capture the specific capabilities that we were seeing in specific BI tools. So things like Hadoop support, is this software able to connect to an open source, the open source framework of Hadoop to then, have big data processing occur on a number of machines and have that be seamless. Predictive analytics, does this BI tool, does it inherently natively in its code able to forecast and provide future looking algorithms and those sorts of models to the user. Streaming analytics, does the BI tool allow for, similar to the Metro St. Louis example we were talking about, does this BI tool allow for meaningful views of real-time data? Can it analyze and crunch all that data, in the count of 1 second? text analytics. You know, can this BI tool go through a variety of, you know, open text, open string data and provide meaningful insights? The last one, the last category of custom functions, noted that BI tools are interested in presenting geographic-based data meaningfully. So if your organization is collecting data and cares about, you know, where specific things occur, you know, those are the tools that you would be looking at. And then the last one is embedded BI, and this is the tool able to, in its code, able to easily be placed within existing systems within an organization. Classic use cases here are organizations that have already in place a robust system that tracks, say, your finances. But what they're looking for is a BI tool that's new, that's able to accentuate those views better and provide better insight. Does that tool allow your organization to very seamlessly place that new tool within your existing infrastructure?
So this is actually the distillation of a lot of work that you all did, and I want to take a minute to describe why, you know, we put this together. And it's because, you know, the vendors in this BI marketplace are going to possess these capabilities, and these capabilities ultimately are going to be what solves your business problem. So challenge of finding the right vendors, or at least the right group of vendors, to start your solicitation conversations, to start understanding your needs. Start with those vendors and research them. So we've got an actual database that we're going to be rolling out really soon that's got all the business intelligence suppliers that you guys analyzed, and the ability to select individual capabilities and see which vendors meet those capabilities. So if you're a buyer out there, you're a program officer watching this, try to understand, use this chart to understand, like, okay, I know what I want to do is actually, you know, what they're calling predictive analytics. And then maybe you also want to have your predictive analytics packaged in a SaaS deployment capability. You can go into our database now and select SaaS, select predictive analytics, and it'll return all the public sector focused vendors. And that was a key distinction for us. We want to make sure the vendors we were pulling in this database had a public sector focus. So you'll be able to pull down those results of the BI suppliers that built and start to research their website, start to research their literature. And as any good contracting professional worth their salt knows, this is how we validate our requirements, how we make sure we're writing the right type of requirements so that we can get the best possible competition for our customers. So basically then in those four different categories, you can see the number of suppliers that we found and how they start to organize themselves. And we're going to go through sort of each category, but talk to me a little bit about sort of this segmentation before we jump in, and why we're bucketing by these four categories. What's the significance here?
So this particular slide, Frank, I think the thinking here was to just show folks a broad snapshot, right, of how the industry is thinking about those capabilities that Richard had talked about, right? So again, as you can see, no surprises really, right? And so forth, you'll find that a lot of vendors are actually providing, you know, going with the SaaS model. Now, of course, there are folks who provide both SaaS as well as on-prem, perpetual license type approaches as well. Right? I think the other thing to call out here is how if you look at the top right graphic, right, you see how streaming analytics, predictive analytics are becoming increasingly important, right? So mm-hmm. More and more organizations are realizing that, you know, when we talk about business intelligence, when we talk about data analysis, we need to start thinking beyond just quantitative data, meaning numbers, right, that you can crunch in mm-hmm. spreadsheets, for instance, and really think about all of the rich, vast troves of data that might be unstructured and, you know, sitting around in your organization, but which, if you properly unlock them, can help you with very valuable information to make better decisions, right? So for instance, that regulatory agency that mined customer complaints, you know, would be a classic example of someone using, you know, text analytics to do predictive analytics, right? So the thinking here to just show folks broad trends and where the industry is moving. In other words, where different organizations are going, right? Because the industry follows the market and the needs of the customers.
Right. Yeah, so the report, again, like, kind of has all this categorization, and like you said, that was sort of the intention, is to help understand, like, how the industry is organizing itself, and that's really helpful for market intelligence. Richard, can you take, like, a minute or two, and we'll go through each of the segments and just provide a little clarity before we move into the last section of our presentation on sort of how to get started on the procurement journey?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. So the first one, traditional BI platforms. So typically we see that these are solutions that are implemented at the enterprise level. So if you think about, you know, a large agency, it's something that, you know, either at the agency level, they're going to be implementing these tools, or at the large department level. And essentially the reason why is because there is such a heavy upfront lift required of plugging in all these different data sources to make sure that as many data sources, relevant data sources as possible, are unified and then also governed. This is preferred, especially when there is a higher need for data security, a lot of sensitivity around the data. Traditionally, what we see with these platforms is that, you know, they tend to have more of the on-premise models deployed. So if your organization is focused on making sure that there is a higher governance threshold over that data before it gets, you know, spit out to the end users, generally they consider traditional BI platforms first.
Nice. And then the big meaty category there, and 293 suppliers in this one, which is neat.
Yeah, so this is out of all the segments, the one that we've put most of the suppliers in this one. And as Vinay mentioned, it is we do see it as part of a larger trend of shifting more of the capabilities of BI into the hands of the end user. So these modern platforms are facilitating that analysis at the end user level. It allows for, you know, organizations that we may be lean prefer to use these modern BI platforms because they trust their end users to, you know, make those decisions, make the analysis, you know, sound, and bring in all the data that they may need. But then at the same time, trusting end users to understand, you know, which data is accurate, which data may not be the best representation of, you know, or the problem that our organization is trying to solve. But these are growing in popularity given, you know, the recent moves to the cloud. It makes these tools easier to implement. So these are better for situations where there's not as much importance placed necessarily on your organization's data sensitivity, not as much emphasis placed on, you know, having that governance structure in place. Instead, just giving all the power to the end user.
Nice. And again, each of these sort of segments are more deeply described in that report, but talk to us about the packaged analytics. There's 106 suppliers that we found in the packaged analytics segment.
Mm-hmm. Sure. So for packaged analytics, these are suppliers that are focused specifically on an industry or on a business line. So it may be that, you know, they're focused specifically on e-commerce, or they're focused specifically on all the HR processes that an organization may need. What they're doing is they're creating these sort of one-stop shop applications that an organization can use to very quickly start seeing the fruits of their labor. Quick wins, if you will, in terms of, you know, we're implementing a BI tool specifically for our HR function. Well, let's not look at the general BI tools that are out there. Let's look at the HR-specific ones. And generally, the providers of these services also have consulting services with it, expertise that comes with the purchasing of that product. So if your organization is specifically looking at a certain problem that you're trying to solve that's unique to a business line or an industry, then this is where we recommend you start.
Nice. And by the way, I'm loving these company logos. I'm sort of like an enthusiast, but to all of these companies that we're showing, they're all in our database. That's correct, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. Super cool. All right. 32 business performance management suites suppliers.
Yeah, so for these suppliers, what they're doing is they're offering solutions that track at a very holistic view all the expansive data sources that an organization may have, bringing all those together into a meaningful way to help transform, you know, all that data into strategic action, into, you know, formulating a new operational plan. The software is mostly used to track KPIs, track metrics, certain processes. We see that these platforms are used mainly at the senior level to allow those users to gain a quick snapshot of how their organization is doing against the, you know, success metrics that they've set out. Now, for the BPMs, we want to caveat is that certainly traditional and modern BI platforms are generally, they can achieve the same outcomes. The key point here is that for BPMs, these are suppliers that are specifically creating software to achieve that holistic view. So if, you know, if what you're looking for is a solution that gives you that quick snapshot view of, you know, how your organization is doing across all the different lines that report up to, you know, management, this is where you would start.
Nice. And finally, believe it's the advanced analytic platforms, a smaller space, but I think for good reason.
Yeah, so this is definitely still an up-and-coming space. You have a lot of platforms that are out there that are enabling data scientists to make, you know, their work easier. But then you also have platforms out there that are using machine learning, using algorithm-based analyses to do a lot of that heavy lifting on the software end. So anything that we found that was used for, you know, this advanced data modeling, advanced statistical analyses, bringing in machine learning, anything that we saw around that in terms of use cases, category, you know, 19 suppliers, still growing, still fledgling. But if your organization is looking for, you know, a platform that allows for these very, very advanced use cases, we recommend looking into these suppliers.
And Frank, I think this, while it is still a small segment, I think it would be quite safe to say that it's a growing segment, right? It's a fast growing segment. I think the use cases here really depend. So this is not for everyone, obviously, right? So this is really for folks, agencies, or organizations that deal with massive terabytes of data that they need to mine through to find patterns and so forth, right? So I think you had a quote from, you know, the Securities and Exchange Commission up front, right? I think that's probably a classic use case for stuff like this, where you really need to look through, you know, literally millions and millions of trades that happen across the equity markets daily to see if there are patterns of insider trading and so forth, right? Or, you know, big internet companies like Facebook, Google, those are guys who are, again, sitting on literally billions of data. You need to mine that to figure out, hey, which ads to serve up to which user, right? So that's a classic use case for true big data analysis, which is where some of these advanced analytic platforms would come in.
Nice, right on. I did want to underline one thing real quick on the packaged analytic applications. I mean, if you're an organization and you're looking for an easy way to test the BI waters, and you have some business problems that you're fairly sure are common, this could be a great way to get started. It's lower capital investment. You see the SaaS deployment there's the majority. So that means you could probably just even test it for a little while. And see if it works, and it just sort of takes your data and runs some classic analyses on there that have worked for other clients. So a lot of times, not necessary to reinvent the wheel with analytics, because most of the time the business problems you're trying to solve, unless you're at that advanced analytics category, are probably things that have been addressed already. So that's sort of really what we want people to be able to do ultimately is understand why they're buying BI and what problem it's going to solve so that you can find the right solution provider. And we've got a quick flow chart here to help the acquisition professional or the program folks out there sort of map out the journey. And this is really the planning stage, right? So, you know, start by defining your problem or the pain points that are facing your organization. Do a really quick diagnostic, especially with that tool that we're providing here, the checklist that you can use about the symptoms. And then create a list of the issues that you hope to address with the BI. And then you can hand that over or work it jointly with your procurement office. Start researching the market. We'll hope you'll use our supplier database when it comes out and the capability down select to find those suppliers that you think are predominantly going to be able to help you. And then you can start to benchmark, right? So we at Public Spend Forum, we have a lot of our membership comes from state, local, federal governments, and in my opinion, way to learn how to do something is to talk to others that have done it before. And so benchmarking, connecting with peer organizations, you know, through our discussion groups or connecting with other professionals through our profiles is a great way to gather lessons learned and start to understand sort of the research techniques that they've done and ultimately the application and implementing that solution. So we're also big fans of rapid prototyping and piloting. I talked about the package analytics solutions. That's something that you could prototype fairly easily. It might have sandbox environments where you could bring in a subset of your data and run some analytics on it to see if you get the insights that you're expecting to achieve. So you certainly don't have to today, especially with SaaS platforms, spend a year implementing a solution and not generating benefit from it. There's a lot more, you know, incremental way to do that and to get value right away before you commit, you know, to like a big enterprise installation. And, you know, once you've done those things, it's about defining the requirement. We always like simple performance work statements are excellent, especially if your needs are pretty common or you have some common needs, but you also have some nuanced needs. Write a performance work statement or statement of objectives that describes to the providers the business problems you want to solve and let them propose to you the types of technologies and solutions that are going to help you solve those problems. I always say don't substitute your expertise for that of the market unless you have it. And then finally, like, incorporate those lean philosophies, prototyping, piloting strategies, test out solutions early before you commit, and I think that's a great way to keep yourself on track. So I've mentioned the database a few times, and I do want to promote it again. When it comes out, it's going to have a ton of great information about the suppliers in this space, all the ones that Richard and Vinay and their team researched in developing the report. If you're a supplier, we pulled publicly available data. You may have a profile in here already. Feel free to reach out to us your profile. We can tell you about some of the really neat things you can do in there to make yourself more findable and discoverable by the public sector buyers out there. That's pretty much all we have for today. And we've got 2 minutes left. Vinay or Richard, any closing comments that you guys might have?
Nothing from my end, Frank. It was a pleasure. I thank everyone for attending today's session. Hope the information was useful, and definitely, we wish you good luck on your business intelligence buying journey.
That's right. And definitely download the report. These guys worked really hard on it, and it's well worth a read. And stay tuned for future webinars that we're going to have in this. I know we got one coming up on March 8th with Professor Rob Hanfield from NC State, one of the leading academics researching public sector spend analytics. And so, if discovering trends and finding ways to be more efficient with your spending is a priority of yours, you will not want to miss that webinar on March 8th. Another in this series on business intelligence, probably with some suppliers that we'll bring on that can help you, the buyer or the program person, understand ways to make your solicitation or your requirement more attractive to them, because we do want to put solicitations out there that are going to get the best competition in the market. So that's what we got in store for you from Public Spend Forum in the BI vertical. And we'll hope you will explore the resources that we provide. And look out in your email. We'll send out sort of a summary email with the links to the reports we've talked about today and the downloadables, and also a link to view this recorded webinar here at your leisure. So thank you, Richard. Thank you, Vinay. We really appreciate your time. And we're going to go ahead and sign out here from Public Spend Forum. Thanks, folks.